Hafide, and welcome to another episode. I want to thank you for watching wherever that may be on TV8, TV11, or Facebook, even our KUAM News YouTube page. Thank you guys for joining us. And today, I felt like we should catch up with someone that's no stranger to the show. So joining me here, we have Brent Tibbetts from the Guam Department of Agriculture, Division of Aquatic and Wildlife Resources. Brent Hafide, welcome to the show.
Hafide, Andy, thank you for having me today.
It's good. It's always good talking to you. And I've had you on my radio show for several years now, whenever there's a fishing derby or something coming up. And it's a good excuse to kind of talk about one of our most precious resources, which is the ocean, the waterways around us, and the wildlife that lives there. So there's quite a bit that I wanted to talk about today. Marine Lab, they are celebrating their 50th. Actually, 2020 was their 50th anniversary. So we're going to get into that a little bit later, talk about what they have planned. And I wanted to talk about what you guys over there at Aquatics and Wildlife have planned, because you've kind of had a year to regroup, plan some things, and get ready to get after it. So we're going to get into that. But first, as we were talking before the show, I kind of wanted to rewind a little bit and talk about what happened during the pandemic, because, you know, the wildlife, the ocean, it doesn't take time off, you know, it's not on lockdown. So life went on. But for you guys, you always have these events planned, you know, the derbies, the little fishing competitions are always fun. So all that stuff got put on hold. So talk about what you guys have been up to during the pandemic while a lot of the operations were kind of paused.
Okay. During the earliest part of the COVID impact, from say March up until about June, we were, most staff were just staying at home and working from home, if anything, just on computers. There were occasions where we had to come into the office for a few hours to do permitting or documentation or you know, things like that. But for the most part, people were just at home. In the middle of the summer, June through about middle of August or so, we were able to kind of resume normal operations for a while. We were out doing, continuing our surveys where we interview fishermen, or doing our surveys in the water where we're counting fish, and interacting with people more face-to-face. But then we went into a kind of a second shutdown area from about the middle of August to recently. And during that time, again, a lot of the staff stayed home. One of the things that we do regularly is we go out and talk to fishermen and get information about fishing, see what they're catching, how much effort they're putting in, where they're fishing, things like that. The face-to-face interviews we were not able to do with COVID regulations, but we were able to continue to do surveys where we just counted fishing activity. So we would have staff just literally drive around the island, stop everywhere you see somebody fishing and take a bunch of notes about the fishing, what kind they're doing, where they're doing it, what are the waves like, the clouds like, the weather's like, what's the tide like, and things like that. And we have been doing these a couple times a month at least for the last 35 years or so. But because of the lack of other surveys we were doing, we increased the number of those. So instead of doing two a month, we were doing 16 a month to really get a feel for, at least we could see how much activity was going on and see, get a feel for how much maybe was an impact due to COVID regulations, where people were not able to go out on the boat, so they went fishing from shore instead, or they weren't able to go out at all because of, you know, friends can't go out or something, or they couldn't, they want to go out by themselves. But we got a really good feel. Now we've got, you know, 4 or 5 months of data of what the fishing from shore was like around Guam for this time, a very good snapshot of that. And that may be used in the future to maybe adjust our estimates about of how much fishing is going on around Guam. We'll continue those surveys and we'll see if we see changes once activities go back to normal levels again.
Yeah, that's something that is pretty interesting. And I did want to ask you about that. You know, you've seen the memes or an article, you know, that nature is coming back and life is returning because of the lack of people and pollution and whatnot. So there's no real solid evidence, but you've been around this, you know, for long enough to kind of see the way things are trending. And you think that the lack of people had a positive impact on the wildlife?
It may have both the lack of bodies in the water and the lack of other activities that may have affected conditions in the water as well. Now, we have seen some changes in the last year from our fish counts that we're doing in the water and some things, but it's too soon to say definitively that those are because of effects of COVID. You know, it'll take probably a couple more years of monitoring to see if this was a one-time thing, or if this is the beginning of a new trend in how things are in the ocean around Guam. But
and that's one thing that I think a lot of people need to understand is when you do see those articles where, you know, scientists discover this or scientists have determined this, there's about 10 years, 15 years of work before then that you get to that point where they can make those claims.
Yeah, it's not something I say, I'm going to write something for this Saturday that's going to prove it. I wish it was that easy, but it's not at all. It's a long time period. And you want to be confident what you're saying is accurate. And so the more data you can have to back that up, the better you are. You know, the better off it is to be published, because you don't want to be publishing something that's misleading or false.
It could just be a fluke. It could just be, you know, the water temperature was at the proper whatever this year, and so there was a little bloom. It could be a number of other things.
Exactly. Somebody had a bunch of babies this year, so suddenly we're seeing a bunch of young ones on there again, just because that pair had a good batch of babies. We don't know until we see a few years down the line if things have changed or not. Exactly right.
But kind of an eyeball guess, you're looking like that it's pretty positive. So, I mean, this is something that scientists have been telling people for, you know, decades now, is that human impact plays a huge role in the population of our wildlife.
It does. And one of the things that has been noticed is earlier in 2020, we were kind of anticipating that Guam was going to go into conditions where we're going to start to see some coral bleaching happening. Water is going to get too warm and corals are going to respond to that by paling and bleaching. But we did towards the end of the year run into, we had several storms come by, cloudy weather, rainy weather, and that's cools the water and, you know, blocks some sun. And that's actually beneficial to the coral. So it appears that we've gone through, you know, the worst part of when bleaching was expected to be happening, with not nearly as much bleaching, if any at all, that was seen. And that's a beneficial thing, you know, again, that came about in 2020, but that definitely we could not attribute to COVID effects. It was Mother Nature happened to cool us off right at the right time. Yeah. And now going out now and observing corals, now you see very little signs of bleaching, when the fears were 6 months ago that we were going to see a lot of bleaching at this time.
It's interesting to me just how fragile but resilient that ecosystem is. You know what I mean? It's like,
yeah.
Is it extremely fragile, or is it as tough as it can possibly be?
Yeah. Well, and that's one of the things actually that the Marine Lab is working on. One of their biggest projects of this year is that they've got a grant to look at coral reef resiliency. How well do the coral reefs bounce back from environmental impacts like that? And also, one of the things generally, the kind of the way of thinking is that a habitat, the more organisms in an environment, the more resilient it is to changes. You have some things that are more affected than others, but overall, they seem to be more resilient. And so part of that also is looking at the diversity of the organisms that live on the reefs around Guam. It's part of that same grant that the Marine Lab is working on. And that'll be going on probably for the next several years. That's an EPSCoR grant, quite a bit of money and quite a bit of work to be done. It sounds like almost all of the faculty at the Marine Lab will be working on some aspect of that or another. And we will be working with them on parts of that as well to document both, you know, new organisms that show up. I put fish on Facebook, on my Facebook feed, and we had one come in over the weekend that only been one ever seen on Guam before.
Oh, really?
And a fisherman landed one this weekend. So
what does it tell still, us about it?
Oh, there's a group of fish that live on shallow on the reefs that are very common called cardinal fish. Lancy is the name in Chamorro for them. This is a big one. It's about 6 inches long, which is big, pretty big for cardinal fish. And it was very deep. It was caught at probably about 600 feet deep, which is very unusual. There are only a couple of species of cardinal fish worldwide that live in water that deep. And this one, there's only been one other record, this one from Guam many years ago. And 600 feet deep is much deeper than they have been known anywhere in the world. The previous estimates were deep. They maybe go down to about 300, 350 feet. So it was interesting to see this fish, first of all, but also where it was caught was very interesting, because that's much deeper than they were ever known before. And, you know, again, I could say, well, you know, it's because of COVID and water quality was too hot, so it went, had to go down deeper. But it's probably not the case. It just that it's somewhere where people don't fish a lot, or it's not a common fish to catch anyway. It just so happened this hook dropped in the right place at the right time, and we got a new specimen because of it.
So as a marine biologist, that's kind of a eureka moment, isn't it?
I am embarrassed to say how geeked out I get when something like that happens. It made yesterday, my whole day was made because of the fish that were caught over the weekend. It really is exciting to see something new like that.
That's great. We need to see more. Is there an article up or just post on your Facebook?
I just put the pictures up with the names, and the one that the cardinal fish, I put a little description underneath of why it was so exciting to see that. But all three different species of fish came in, and they're all uncommon here. One of them was originally described from Guam, and the first time it was ever seen scientifically was a specimen caught on Guam, but it's never been common here. And a gentleman caught a couple over the weekend, and they're not really big enough to be food fish, but he thought they were of interest to him, and he knew they'd be of interest to me, so he saved them and brought them by, and I was very, very happy to see that. And they're going to be, they're all three are going to be used for various studies, either locally here or sometimes regional museums, or some things we're going to probably be sending to the Smithsonian as well. So nationally, some of the unusual things that are turning up will be used for scientific purposes, not just to say I've got a cool picture of this weird thing, that there will be some use. Although
okay, we're not just going to mount it on the wall and have it sitting above your desk.
Exactly. That's enough for me, but there actually will be something good coming out of them when they're sent to the authorities around the world on these groups of fish.
Yeah, interesting stuff. And that's the thing that, you know, before I even moved to Guam and I was applying for colleges, the UOG Marine Lab, it always came up. It's a world-class facility. And our location here, right by the trench, with all the biodiversity in our waters, it's such a great location for it. And it just goes to show that, you know, as long as we've been studying these animals, there's still new discoveries or animals that we thought maybe had, you know, didn't exist anymore, become extinct, but they're still out there. And so the work continues. And that's all part of your programs where you have these partnerships with different agencies, different organizations. And I know that you've mentioned it before. One of the best partners you have is the actual fishermen here on island. They're kind of your boots on the ground. You mentioned it with the little census that you take, you know, when you go out, you see the fishermen, ask them what they're catching, what's running. And so they're pretty important, and they are not forgotten. And in all this pandemic, we've heard a lot of talk of the, you know, unemployment assistance and the stimulus checks. Fishermen have not been left out of that. So let's go ahead and talk about that and the relief for them.
Great. Yeah, I appreciate that. Yes, Department of Ag was given money earlier this year from the feds appropriated money for fishermen of Guam to help alleviate some of the impacts of COVID. At the time, which was about the middle of the year, June, July, we had fishermen come in and register as fishermen. And once we got the full set of people who had registered, we submit that list to the federal government with our payment plan. We were given almost $1 million. This is how it's going to be dispensed between some commercial fishermen, but the majority are just people who fish to feed the family or things like that. And so the feds approved our plan and sent it back and said, okay, now people who registered earlier last year have to come back and do an affidavit saying, yeah, what we wrote was true. And also a tax form. This income does have to be at least claimed on tax next year. It doesn't mean that, you know, it'll be put you into a different tax status or affect maybe other impacts, you know, SNAP benefits or things like that. But you do have to acknowledge that this is going to be claimed on taxes next year. We have not had a great deal of the people who were initially registered come in to do the second level of paperwork, and they have to do that to get the check. So we're working to get the word out to fishers to remind them that they have to do that, because we're not going to get the money. If it doesn't given out to fishermen, we don't know what's going to happen with it. But we want it to get to the people who need it and deserve it, the fishers of Guam. But they do have to do these last two forms to qualify for that. Now, the two forms, literally, it's probably 5 minutes of reading and signing a couple of lines, and then you're good to go. But we have to have those forms to be able to send the checks out. So we're trying to get the word out. Please, if you registered last year, come back in and do these last two documents, and then you're qualified to receive the check.
I wonder if people are intimidated by the fact that, you know, it's a tax form and they're like, well, I'm just a hobbyist, or, you know, I catch a few fish to have dinner a couple nights a week. So do I qualify? So who exactly is eligible for this money?
Everybody who filled out the registration forms last year, maybe June or July, I think July 30th was the deadline to turn those forms in. So it was the month and a half or 2 months prior to that. Everybody who filled those out pretty much is qualified for this money, but you have to come back and fill out those last two documents to get to have the check sent to you. And we had over 800 people register as fishers in the summer, and I don't think we've even had 200 of those come back to do their tax forms yet. So a lot of people are still, we're trying, we've had people going out to the marinas, putting out on social media, on regular media, TV, radio, things like that, print media, to get people to come fill these things out. We really need to have that done because we want this money to get out to the people who deserve it.
It's just sitting there right now. And if it's not given to the fishermen, it's going to go back to the feds or off island somewhere where it's not going to help anybody here.
That's our friend. Yeah. Yeah. And so please, if you registered and haven't come back to those last two forms, you can come to the Department of Agriculture. We have the forms here. We also have people going out to the marinas with the forms. They can do them on site if you're going out fishing there. And you can call Department of Agriculture if you have any other questions or want information on it.
Fantastic. So we've talked about what happened over the year and, pandemic and whatnot. Let's go ahead and look forward. You guys have had plenty of time to kind of regroup and maybe plan some things, and all those events that were put on hold, you're, I'm sure, chomping at the bit right now to get after it. So what do you guys have planned for this year?
Well, we've got a list of things. Thanks for saying that. What I had mentioned earlier, how we do these surveys where we go out and talk to fishermen, and those started up again last week, and those are going to be continuing through the year again. We've been doing those surveys since 1985, the shore-based ones. So we have 35 years of data on that, and that will continue. We also do interviews where we talk to fishermen who go out in boats and come in, and we see at the end of the day how the catch was and where they were fishing, things like that. And those surveys we've been doing since 1982, we have almost 40 years of data on those now. So those are going to continue. And at the end of every year, we create a report on kind of the status of fish and fishing on Guam for the year. And that's something that's available online. We submit this information to the Western Pacific Fisheries Council, the entity that's tasked with managing fisheries in the Western Pacific, CNMI, American Samoa, and Hawaii. And then we generate a report with them, and that's available online for anybody to look at. Fishers are welcome to look at it and check and see, if you've been talked to by our staff, this is where that information is going. That's a concern fishermen have sometimes. I'm giving you guys this information, what am I getting out of it? And it's a fair question. And so we'd like to show what the reports that are generated from their information look like and talk and tell about the fishing on Guam. And if I encourage fishermen to look at it, and if they have any questions or concerns or anything, absolutely contact us and let us know. This the same thing. We want to make sure that the data that's going out is as accurate as possible. And fishermen are the primary data collectors for these reports. And so we want to make sure that what is being reported accurately reflects what's going on out on the water.
And this is a great tool for fishermen as well. Just put this in the tackle box that, the better information that they have, the better catch they'll have.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that we try to use with the information is give people idea of the seasonality of some species, when you should expect to see them around, so they can kind of prepare for that. Minnehaha is a great example where we have a pretty good feel now, almost down to the day when they're going to come in. And that's based on interviewing fishermen in the past when they've caught them and looking at other aspects, tide and waves and moon phase, things like that, putting them all together. And now we've got a pretty good feel for when they're going to come in. The same thing with the open ocean fish, the mahi-mahi, the wahoo, the marlin, the tuna, things like that. Looking at years of catch information, we have a good idea of when those come in, and we like to get that information out to fishers so they can plan their fishing accordingly. Now, a lot of the experienced fishers know it anyway, but for anybody else and anybody, it's to see the catch records back up what people's gut feelings are for things.
Right. And another event that is always fun are those little the derbies you have, the onshore ones for the kids. Do we have one of those planned?
Yes, we have two of those planned, actually. Okay. Those are always very fun for us. It's one of our staff's favorite things to do every year. It's just a lot of fun to get outdoors, not sit at your desk all day and interact with kids.
No more Zoom meetings.
Yeah, well, yeah, not that I don't like them, but I don't like them. So so get out and interact with the kids. And it's a lot of fun to see kids catching stuff. And we do get a little fisheries information out of it. But the primary function is to get kids to enjoy fishing, get outdoors and enjoy stuff. I hate to think how many kids have kind of sheltered indoors over the last several months and been afraid to get out and do stuff. And we really want to encourage them to start getting out again. And I think fishing is a good way to do that. And so we're looking at kind of the tides and things for the summertime, but we'll probably have two this summer, maybe June, July, and August, somewhere in that 3 month span. We'll be hosting two kids fishing derbies again. And we'll get there'll be media announcements when we know the dates for sure, but we need to plan it. You know, fishing generally from shore is generally better when the tide is coming in. So we try to schedule the derbies accordingly so that the kids will have the best chance of catching fish if possible.
Fantastic. Looking forward to that. Always a fun event. And we mentioned it, Marine Lab celebrating their 50th. We were going to have someone from the lab join us here, but they had some, you know, science duties or something pop up. So
they're always busy being on there. I know that I was talking to them that they're going to reschedule the 50th anniversary for this year. Sometime there will be some event. I hate to say I was there for the 25th anniversary event. I was a student at the Marine Lab at that time. So I've been around there a while, but I'm not sure exactly what's happening, but I know there's going to be some functions down there and some, stuff on media, old pictures and stories and old faculty and alumni have been contacted about presenting some stuff as an alumni of the Marine Lab from many years ago. And so I'm looking forward to that. My understanding is it's closer to the summer, maybe May or something like that, but I'm sure they will have exact dates and they'll be putting it out for consumption when they know for sure.
So there's much to look forward to this year and, exciting discoveries, your cardinal fish that recently showed up. You never know what this year is going to bring. So it's always nice catching up with you, Brent. I want to thank you very much for joining the show. Anything you want to add before we let you get back to studying the fish?
No, just to keep an eye. We have a lot of other, we know we're doing sea turtle monitoring, things like that still. So that'll continue. Wonder if I can get out the phone numbers for people to call about that COVID funding. That would be great. Appreciate it. I'll have three numbers for you to call. 735-0288, 0281, or 0294. Those are three of our staff who are ready to answer any questions people have about the COVID or if they qualify or any other questions about it. Please call, because we really want to make sure this money gets out to the people who deserve it.
This money is burning a hole in your pocket, Brent, so we need to get it to the fishermen.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, Brent, it's always a pleasure talking with you. I know that we could go on and on and on, but we are limited for time. So thank you again, and I appreciate it.
Well, I appreciate the opportunity to talk with you, and I hope to have another face-to-face before our kids' derbies later this year.
I hope so.
Great. Thank you very much.